Mushrooms are capable of so many things.
They can be an ingredient in delicious meals, prompt feelings of euphoria,
and help keep our soils healthy. But did you know that they could also eat plastic? I know it sounds impossible, but recent studies show that certain types of mushrooms can degrade plastic and convert it into organic matter. And this research has been applied to art installations like this Plastomatch, aka a plastic stomach, that's actively munching away at plastic. It's so cool. But I wanna know, can this solution apply to all fungi and all plastics? Can I grow fungi at home to eat my waste? And can this solution be scaled up to clean up our landfills? Let's find out. On this episode of Can It Save the Planet, I'm talking to a fungi materials expert and a sculpture artist to learn more about how mushrooms can be used as a resource, and ultimately find out if mushrooms can save the planet.
Presented by Astral Tequila.
Since large-scale plastic production started in the early 50s, we have generated more than 8 billion metric tons of plastic. Sadly, estimates suggest that about 11 million metric tons of plastic enter the ocean each year, and this is expected to nearly triple by 2040. And because plastic can take centuries to decompose, like this bottle, which could take up to 450 years to break down, scientists are looking into new ways to get rid of plastic polluting the Earth. One solution is mushrooms. Mycologists estimate there are somewhere between 2.2 and 3.8 million species of fungi on Earth, but there are over 100 types of fungi with documented plastic degrading capabilities. According to a study from 2011 on plastic eating mushrooms, some fungi species from the Amazon, like the Pestalitiopsis microspora, P. microspora for short, were found to digest plastic and turn it into organic matter. The experiment focused on fungi decomposing synthetic polymer polyester, the kind of plastic we see in all sorts of things, including kitchen sponges, furniture, and even clothing. The study also demonstrated how certain strains of P. microspora could degrade plastic in dry areas with no oxygen. Which is great, because areas with little to no oxygen, like in a landfill, make it nearly impossible for things to biodegrade properly. There have also been studies that focus on using fungi to break down more common plastics made out of polyethylene, PET for short, so things like milk cartons, detergent bottles, toys, and other household items. There's actually a researcher in Austria who created a nursery using oyster mushrooms to decompose plastic while still creating edible mushrooms. It's kind of awesome that they can do all of that. It'd be great if we can use them to clean up the ocean, which is littered with plastic pollution, as we see in the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. But research on the scaling and impact of plastic-eating fungi is still very limited. So I need to talk to someone who's researched fungi. Dr. Sonia Travaglini is a fungi materials expert whose research focuses on developing and testing how mushrooms can generate strong, versatile fibers simply from eating waste. But can all fungi eat plastic? And can all plastic be digested by fungi?
Not all fungi can eat all plastic, but there is over 5 million species of fungi that they've found just so far. There's species of fungi that will eat low-density polyethylene, that's your milk bottles, and polyurethane, which is packaging. Each species of mushrooms eats a little bit different, but most of them use a hyphal network, or a network of their bodies, to go out and find the food they like. Then they'll secrete enzymes that will eat away at each piece of the material, nom it up, turn it into their own body made of carbon, and then either sit there until they just chill happily, or they'll extend their hyphal network.
But Sonia says the speed at which fungi can degrade plastic depends on many factors, like the species of mushroom and the environment it's in.
Some mushrooms will degrade things in minutes, some will take months. Typically, it's months for them to munch through the plastic.
And when it comes to scaling up the solution, what are some of the obstacles we're gonna face?
You really wanna make sure that you have the right type of mushroom eating the right type of waste you want to get rid of. Mushrooms can easily take over. The largest one is in Oregon and is the size of an entire forest. So you wanna make sure that you pick the right mushroom that just wants to eat your trash.
Are there any possibilities of those mushrooms, say they get tired of eating plastic and they're like, we're gonna go eat something else?
There are fungi that do get into ants' brains, take over their body and control them. But the likelihood of a plastic-eating fungi doing that is very low. After all, there's fungi growing on us right now and they're perfectly happy where they are.
So plastic pollution is one thing mushrooms can fix, but there's so much more they can do.
So far, we've looked at packaging. There are folks out there using it to replace leather. There are folks out there using it as a sustainable food source. And it can actually help pollution. For example, if you had an oil spill, you can soak up that oil with straw, and then a mushroom will come along, eat the oil and the straw, and make a perfectly lovely environment.
Wow, so mushrooms are amazing. So amazing that even artists have started using them in their art. Elizabeth Demaray is a sculptress who's focused her art around the natural environment, one of them being the plastomatch.
Plastomatch is a combination of plastic and stomach. So this is a sculpture that is eating plastic by virtue of living fungi. The plastics that are in this particular version of the plastomatch are really all kinds of different consumer plastics. There's an entire milk bottle that runs through. They left it down at World Trade. So so I chopped
it
up.
The amount of pollution, the amount of trash.
I know. This is based on studies about what white rot fungi can digest. And white rot fungi is interesting. When it eats wood, the carbon chains in wood look a lot like the carbon chains in plastic.
I would love to have one of these at home. Unfortunately, it's a very lengthy process and it takes all the right conditions for it to be successful.
It takes a long time for fungi to eat plastic, and there are a lot of things you have to do. The first thing that you have to do is you have to wash it really well. You've got to make sure that there's no other molds or anything else that could compete with the fungi. If your plastic footprint was very, very small, this could potentially be a solution.
It's also not recommended to harvest and consume the mushroom you grow.
If you are using plastic debris, you don't know what kinds of contaminants are in it, what kinds of dyes are in it, what kinds of metals are in it. So you cannot eat anything that's grown in a plastomatch.
What about this plastic?
So this is vinyl. They shouldn't be able to
right.
eat it. It's entirely possible that something's going on that I'm not entirely aware of.
I'm just growing a new species.
Yeah, maybe so, yeah.
So now that we've seen plastic eating mushrooms at work, I think we have our conclusion.
Here's a recap of what we learned. Number one, only certain mushrooms have been found to eat certain kinds of plastic. Number two, so far this solution can only work in controlled environments like a lab, farm, or an art installation. And number three, plastic eating mushroom research is still very nascent and needs more time before we start spraying large piles of trash with fungi spores. So, can mushrooms save the planet? Not yet, but maybe someday. In theory, this would be a great solution, but there's still a lot more research needed. One area of concern is the potential for one of the plastic-eating fungi, P. microspora, to transfer its genes to other species and vice versa. Too wordy, I know, but what that means is that a mushroom can consume genes from bacteria and viruses and then transfer them to other species. For example, it can contract pathogens like cholera and infect humans that come into contact with it. There are also concerns surrounding the possibility that a trash-eating enzyme could spread out of control, digesting things other than plastic. But don't worry, we're not going to become zombies from fungi. Another obstacle is application and scaling. There's no real answer as to how we scale this solution to become commercially viable, or if it'll even be sustainable enough in the grand scheme of things. Basically saying that if we don't know how to profit from it, then why implement it? Now, I don't want to take away from all the great things mushrooms can do. World-renowned mycologist Paul Stamets highlights a lot of these applications in his TED Talk, like cleaning up polluted soils, making insecticides, and even creating a sustainable fuel source. And experts like Sonia have looked into replacing packaging materials with biodegradable material that's made from mushrooms and can just go on to make even more mushrooms. Then there's the possibility to grow your own oyster mushrooms at home by feeding them plastic while creating edible mushrooms. But as Elizabeth said, it's not the safest and more research is needed. All of this is very exciting. However, as I said, more studies are needed to determine the overall long-term safety of plastic-eating mushrooms, whether it's for eating or plastic waste management. At the end of the day, our current solution to eliminating our plastic waste is reducing our consumption and production of said plastics.
In the meantime, I'm gonna keep growing my own edible mushrooms at home. Safely, of course.